what we've seen now, especially over the last 15 years, is a really big improvement in the vegetation on the island. So from a vegetation point of view, the island is in great shape.
I was able to have a very short visit in 2010 to actually personally see the damage. And I was just on slopes over there seeing the degradation, rabbits hopping on the hillside. And so it's such an immense privilege to watch it recover in the subsequent 10 years. And now it's flourishing with mega herbs, cabbage, polifoliosa, the tussock we have all around. And it's just incredible everywhere. Very ambitious. I think some people didn't quite realise how ambitious it really was. We were tackling three different introduced species all at once on such a remote, challenging island, mostly in the winter. And at the time, it was like a groundbreaking international conservation success that we should all really be proud of.
One of the reasons that we're so committed to long-term monitoring on the island is because without this long-term data, it's really hard to identify change. And change can occur for a whole range of reasons. And at the moment, we're seeing change in relation to the vegetation improving, but we've got climate changes on Macquarie Island. We've got the spectre of avian influenza. We've got a lot of potential change. And without this monitoring, we really can't understand what the trajectories are and what we can do to help manage it.
Strict biosecurity measures. So biosecurity threats are almost probably our number one threat across the whole island. So we just need to be really, really vigilant. And the main risk is the reintroduction of rodents, but also insects that are really important to keep track of because they have huge ecosystem impacts. And also weeds. It would be probably impossible to eradicate any of those species if they became established. So it's much cheaper and effective just to prevent them becoming established in the first place.